that you have been made to wait for so long. We thought that we would prepare ourselves for about 40 minutes of technical preparation, but inevitably it took longer. What I'd like to do maybe is to talk in general terms about where I think I am at and where I am going, but I really want to be able to entertain you by showing you as many clips as possible. Since however much I talk, I'm sure the evidence of what is produced is far more important. I get the impression, for having spoken indeed to some of you yesterday, and to understand, I suppose, the parameters of your particular film festival, that most of you in the audience here, if not totally professional, are semi-professional. Is that true? You're all practitioners. Is that right? Put your hands up who believe that you're all practitioners. Are you all painters or filmmakers or video artists? It's difficult to see. Could we have the lights up again, please, so I can see the audience? Good. Okay, can you show me your hands again? Good. Okay. It's curious, I have different sorts of audiences in different locations under different circumstances. And often, I suppose, a lot of the audiences are, shall we say, quote-unquote, general. But you are rather a specific audience, I feel. One of the questions, and I suppose provocations, that I like to ask audiences is to believe, and I'm going to ask it to you, do you believe that you are visually literate? Are you trained to be visually literate? Who has been to art school? Who has been to design college? Put your hands up again. Put your hands really up so I can really see you. Anybody else want to volunteer a hand? No? Because what normally happens, you know, whether I'm talking to chimpanzees in, I don't know, Addis Ababa, or I'm talking to super sophisticated people in Silicon Valley, the proportion of people who really feel themselves to be visually literate is really quite small. I think probably the going rate is about 8%. You're a little better. I see from your show of hands you're about 10%. But it is curious, isn't it? You know, we are now in a digital age. Umberto Eco says with great delight, it's about time that the text masters should move aside and allow the vision masters, and really seriously for the first time, the vision mistresses, to come forward to reconfabulate the way in which we see ourselves. I suppose all the world's knowledge and all the world's communication essentially for the last 8,000 years has been through text, 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 text. And all of us across all the language barriers are very good at it. We have all been trained copiously. We spend, I suppose, early childhood learning the alphabet. We spend our adolescence piling up the words. And even as adults, we never ever finish polishing and polishing and polishing, because we use text every day, both written and spoken. But the proportion of people who spend as much fascination, as much interest, as much intelligence, and simply as much time hours with the same sense of intensity that we spend with text to do with image is comparatively very small. You know, all over the world, when you're about 10 or 11 or 12, the teacher says, put away the easel, put away the crayons, get serious. Now you have to spend the rest of your life dealing with text, 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 text. And what does that mean? I don't know, what's the average age now in Italy, longevity? What is it? Men are supposed to reach about, what, 75? Women a bit longer? So if you put away the pens and the pencils when you're 10, that's 70 years of barrenness, because most people never pick up a pencil or a pen ever again and never really seriously engage in anything that's really essentially visual communication. What a barren life that is, don't you think? 70 years without a pen or a pencil in your hand. The desire to be able to participate both theoretically and practically in the businesses of notions of visual communication. Rembrandt famously said, just because you've got eyes doesn't mean to say that you can see. The same amount of attention is necessary to become sophisticated in visual communication as it is in textual education. But the world systems do not really readily recognize that, do they? But I think ever since 1983, when the so-called visual digital revolution began, we can, I suppose, quarrel about that date, but as generally regarded now, I'll make it even more specific, the 31st of September 1983, when cinema died. It died because cinema, as you know, ever since the Méliès brothers, way back, 1895, is essentially a passive preoccupation. Most people do not engage in the cinema, or have not until the present day, in any active way. But I think, though it's a little apocryphal, of course, the 31st of September 1983 can be said to be the date when the zapper, or the remote control, was introduced into the living rooms of the world. And although you are a long way from your television set in your living room, and perhaps all you could do with your zapper or remote control was to turn the television on and turn the television off, it was the beginning of the end. Because that, from that point on, in a curious way, cinema became active, proactive, interactive. You had choice, you could intervene. The audience became no longer a virgin, but became replete and enfranchised with the possibility of interfering with the image. And we know what's happened from 1983, certainly to 2014, huge amounts of sophistication. I think I can say this in a Roman Catholic country, though I suspect most of you are now all atheists, though your grandmothers were certainly Roman Catholics. There is a new Trinity abroad. It is not no longer God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. It's God the mobile phone, his Son is the laptop, and the Holy Spirit is now the camera recorder. Just as the first Trinity was empowering for 2,000 years, the new technological aesthetic Trinity is also now incredibly empowering. Is there anybody in the audience who does not possess a mobile phone, a laptop, and some sort of camera recorder? Don't be shy. You all possess those three objects, I'm sure. Yes? Not only as professional practitioners, but totally in your private life. So you're all deeply empowered. And of course, that also makes you, in technological terms, all active members of cinema. You are all filmmakers. I think Tarantino, no less than Mr. Tarantino at the Cannes Film Festival recently, said that cinema is finally dead. So even that retrobate, that very old-fashioned filmmaker, has finally caught up. Well, Godard, of course, has been saying the cinema is dead ever since about 1983. He recognized with the notion of empowering enfranchisement, where we all become filmmakers, it really is the beginning of the end. I don't think we ought to vote, any of us, and I'm sure you're not, or I certainly hope you're not, in any way disappointed by this effect, because what happens next is going to be so much more exciting, enfranchising, and wonderful than what has happened heretofore. But we have to get there, and we have to get there by a process, I suppose, of learning and education, and making. To repeat my first remark, it's all very well to talk about it, but what's most important is to make it. And by making it, you can show and develop and learn and find out what's happening and see where you can put yourself. I suppose a lot of people still have a lot of anxiety about this. A lot of people still believe, of course, that cinema is not dead. But, you know, the cinema of Casablanca, the cinema of our fathers and forefathers is no longer with us. And you, as Italians, certainly ought to know this. You were responsible for the most extraordinary splurge of cinematic activity. I suppose starts with La Dolce Vita and finishes with The Last Emperor. Where on earth is it all gone? Shame on you to have wasted it away. I don't know, do you all think you're responsible for the collapse of the great Italian cinema? some one or two elderly people, certainly not as old as me, but almost, who would certainly be contemporaneous with Olmi and Pasolini and Fellini and all those extraordinary people, but there are an awful lot of young people in the audience. Would you all take collective responsibility for destroying something that was extremely valuable? There's a lady at the back, not sure whether she's going to shake her head or not. Okay, all sorts of factors, of course, are to play. We can't blame Mr. Berlusconi for every evil. But there is a way, indeed, I think, all of us in the audience, both as makers and viewers and as critics and partitioners and cineasts of one description and another, realize there is a new revolution afloat. And I suspect that the circumstances and, the empowering of the festival that's all being represented here is very much alive and well about that. There's another group of people who are so overpowered by the enormity of the revolution and all its manufacturing. Microsoft produces something new for us every single afternoon, and we are obliged, I think, to seize all that activity, all those amazing new tools, in order to continue to push forward in a general, I suppose, human excitement towards the notion of an idea of a desire for speculative audiovisual experience. There's always been such a phenomenon, and there's always been people to cater for it. If you think of the ancient Greeks with their particular auditoriums and their particular amphitheaters and the reliance on the human voice and the architecture that was created to support those notions of drama became extremely sophisticated, and we know about that. We know how the Romans took it over with their Colosseums and their amphitheatres of Pompey's great theatre, indeed, in this particular city. And then I suppose how Christianity took over the desire to provide audiovisual excitements by notions of ceremonial, architecture, singing, dancing, ritual, etc., etc., and that lasted a long time. And then I suppose that maneuvered over post-Renaissance, maybe even during the Renaissance, to the notion of the opera, which satisfied, again, notions of audiovisual excitement. And then I suppose the doomsday, which must be, 1918, when finally, basically, the operatic phenomenon was no longer viable for the real dissemination of ideas. And of course, 1918 could really begin to understand the beginnings of a respect and understanding of how amazing cinema could be. But 1918 to 2014, it's a fairly long time for an aesthetic technology, but I think we can now say, indeed, all characteristics of celluloid cinema have now passed on, and we have new excitements. But some people also feel that such is the enormity of this revolution, how do you handle it? How do you pursue it? How do you coerce it? How do you distribute it? How do you organize it? I suppose each one of us as practitioners or semi-practitioners would need to find their own disciplines. The particular disciplines I think would be relevant to me are based, I think, probably on two general ideas. I have to be able to coerce and organize a huge amounts of opportunities in order to pursue a particular notion and general idea. I think my first anxiety is the fact that the two prime areas, I suppose, of cinematic experience are what I would call the frame and the narrative. And the frame, as you well know, is totally man-made. You will never find a frame in nature. Why is it we coerce, squash, contain, straitjacket the world inside a parallelogram, completely artificial and a convenience? It's a convenience, of course, that also supports notions of the theater. Proscenium arch is the frame. And I suppose when painting separated itself from the notions of architecture around about, 1350, that was the beginning, indeed, for the theater to copy painting, and ultimately the cinema to copy theater, and television, of course, to copy both. But all in our magazines and newspapers, we still look at photographs and images of the world through a frame. You do not see me in a frame. I certainly don't see you in a frame. And I have a gyroscopic head like you and eyes that never stop. So the notion of the frame is remarkably artificial, but obviously we all can understand it has great convenience. And the second thing, more difficult maybe to explain and to express, because I think we're deeply prejudiced, is the notion of the story or the narrative. There's no such thing as a story or narrative in nature. It's a man-made phenomenon. We put our parallels down, our beginnings and middles and ends in a very, very arbitrary fashion, related to our own experience and subjectivity. So I constantly feel that cinema is the heir, and indeed, to the notion of the artificiality of the frame and the artificiality of the narrative. And if we're really going to open up the boundaries of what cinema could be, then those two things certainly have to be deeply explored, and I would suggest to be changed. So ever since, I think, probably in about 1990, I've been trying very hard to see how it's possible to eschew notions of the frame and notions of narrativity in cinematic experience. Let me go a little further. We all know why cinema, says we're, from an outside point of view, is changing, is dying. Some people, certainly me, would say it's dead. Reasons of economics, reasons of the multiplicity of different ways we can now culturally explore, so cinema is no longer on its own. Habits to do, obviously, with enormous amounts of new technology, which have brought the frame and the narrative, in a sense, in a television screen into our households. I think there are seven televisions in my house in Amsterdam. I bet you all of you have more than one television in the places where you live. We're certainly in the age of the screen. There's absolutely no doubt about that. But I doubt anymore if we're in the age of the cinema. Those two things are not necessarily the same phenomenon. But I would think, and for me far more interesting, that the cinema would be dying from within because of what I would regard as four tyrannies. First of all, I've already mentioned the tyranny of the frame. The frame is no longer necessary. We can explode it. We can change it. Cinema's doing that, of course, ever since Abel Gance made Napoleon, playing around with three screens. That was quite primitive because it had to be organized with cumbersome 35mm projectors, which are very, very difficult to synchronize. And then, of course, that's exploded because with tape we can be so much more clever with the notion of the multiplicity of the frame. So I'm looking now for a non-singularity frame cinema. Certainly notions of cinema in 360 degrees, or certainly to rather like the eye of a fly, to give you many, many, many frames, and not necessarily to always organize itself in the present tense, to be able to explore the past, the present, and the future simultaneously, to see rather like Picasso's cubism, both sides of the wall at the same time, and also to be able to engage in scale in a way we've never done before. I can give you the wide shot, the medium shot, and the close-up all at the same time. Those sort of engagements, of course, are not just relative to my particular practice. Everybody's doing it, but I think there's a huge amount of exploration. So my first tyranny, then, when making cinema, is to be very conscious of the notions of the limitations of the frame and, if possible, get rid of it. The second, again, maybe I've already touched on it, is that we have a text-based cinema. We do not have an image-based cinema. Every single film you've ever seen, with remarkably few exceptions, and I would be very interested if you could bring me one, every film starts with a text. They used to say, didn't they, even if that text was on the back of a cigarette packet, but nobody smokes anymore, so I can't use that analogy. But whether your name is Godard or Eisenstein or Almodóvar or indeed Tarantino, I bet you every film starts with a text. So there is a way we have a text-based cinema which is linked to the bookshop. I don't have to say the very obvious fact that one of the biggest, I suppose, filmic activities maybe of the last 12 years are goddamn Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings. And these we know because we can go down to the marketplace outside this theater and buy those books very, very simply and easily. Although that's easy to say, going back to our luminaries, Eisenstein, Godard, and Tarantino, all their products always have a deep, deep association, seminally, with the notion of text. So my next text, or my, should we say, my next concern is to see if we can really savagely break, cut that umbilical cord that links cinema to the bookshop. My third tyranny is probably rather unpopular. The cinema is not a playground for Sharon Stone. It's not Sharon Stone's fault. It's the way we've organized our uses of actors, which is still very primitive, very embryonic, and not much different from the way that Chekhov organized his actors on the stage in the 1880s in St. Petersburg. We still, as it were, denigrate the notion of the actor into realms of pretense, of not being able really, really to exploit them as people. There is still that old 17th century phenomenon that all actors are prostitutes. We still use them as innuendos for our own particular desires and identities and catharsis. And I think that desperately underestimates the use, probably, of actors and actresses. Are there any actors and actresses in the audience? I'm about to insult you. Oh, there's one man boldly putting his hand up. Don't you think, sir, that really an actor or an actress is only somebody who has been trained to pretend that they're not there? Yes? Isn't that, in the moment we find a suspension of disbelief because you make some bad move and create some bad acting, you're lost and we're lost too. So this curious thing is about, you know, am I there, am I not there? What am I doing? How am I organizing in order to be able to express ideas and emotional content? Very strange. I congratulate you for being an actor, but I certainly don't envy you. The fourth tyranny, I feel maybe it's perhaps the most contradictory of all, and there is a camera looking at me there. We have to get rid of the camera. Now that really sounds, doesn't it, primarily contradictory. But the camera is an extremely stupid item with no intelligence, however clever the cameraman, sir, you in the yellow t-shirt, or your studio manager or your producer, there is a way that the camera can only simply record what you put in front of it. It's an object of mimesis. And I often feel that the way peculiar that cinema created may be a, I suppose, an unfortunate beginning. If we make a comparison with measuring earthquakes, it's like this camera has introduced itself into the world at Richter 6, whereas it should have been there at 0. Let me give you two quotations. I think the two greatest visualists of the 20th century are Eisenstein and Picasso. Picasso said, I do not paint what I see, but I paint what I think. And Eisenstein, who goes in 1929 to Mexico to make a film, passes through California, and he meets Walt Disney. And Eisenstein, who I sincerely believe is the greatest film director we've ever had in 119 years of cinema, actually said that Walt Disney was the greatest and most perfect of all filmmakers, because thinking of that comparison of earthquakes, he really started right on the ground. He really started at Richter 0. He starts with a blank screen, no mimesis, no idle reproduction of the world. He creates that world. And of course, Eisenstein is referring to Disney as the ultimate, ultimate filmmaker who's essentially a cartoonist, a man or a woman who starts from ground zero, nothing there to begin with. I'm quite sure that Eisenstein appreciated the irony of what he was saying, because I'm sure, like all of us, he would regard Eisenstein not only as an anti-Semite, not only as an extremely good businessman, but also probably as an extremely good craftsman. But I think that those two notions, we can link that up again. Picasso says, I do not paint what I see, but I paint what I think. Eisenstein says the greatest film director is Walt Disney, and Rembrandt said, just because you've got eyes doesn't mean to say that you can see. These are sort of guidelines which I've made for myself, so I need to avoid these four tyrannies, or abrogate them, or organize them, or make the questioning them no longer relative, and I sincerely have to worry about the abrogation of the notion of the story and the frame. Now, you all might have different ways of organizing how you want to be associated with cinema, post-cinema, pre-cinema, whatever we call it, and those would necessarily be your guidelines. Okay, what I'd like to do now, maybe, is to try and, with those thoughts in mind, show you various examples, all of them quite recent, probably all made in the last 3 or 4 years, where I have certainly tried to make a big embrace of the digital revolution and find ways and means of acknowledging a world full of screens, but not necessarily a world full of cinema anymore. One of the things that even in this country, in Milan, about 4 years ago, made me think about the notion of what do we mean by the relationship of that phenomenon, parallelogram, and you. You seated in an audience in a minute which will go dark. Man is not a nocturnal animal. What on earth are you doing in the dark? Second, you're all going to be looking in one direction. And as Godard famously said, if you're doing that, it means that two-thirds of the world is behind your head and is somehow irrelevant to your experience. It doesn't seem to be physiologically very satisfactory. And if you practice the apogee of the cinematic art, which is surely the 120-minute-long feature film, that means you're going to have to sit still for 120 minutes. And even in your beds last night, your body was never that still for 120 minutes. So sitting in the dark, looking in one direction, being still, is surely really not a very sophisticated physiological situation for you and your body. So that would also suggest that cinema somehow has to become more active. Maybe one of the reasons that could be solved is to go back to the notions of where cinema came from, supposedly came from the fairground or the circus, and certainly from the theater. And there is a way that theater is a three-dimensional experience, although everybody in a theater probably, hopefully, can see the screen or see the stage, that viewpoint is not necessarily the same for you, lady, as it is the same for you, lady. So opera and theater is essentially a three-dimensional experience. But I think that man there, who is seated probably in, what, G12, is the only man who's got a good seat. All the rest of you might as well leave the cinema. He is in the position from where the cameraman took the pictures. So it is the royal seat. You know, in Renaissance theater, there was only one good seat. It's where the king sat. And the orchestra and the pit, the musicians and the players were all essentially aiming their performance at G12. Congratulations, sir, for finding the best seat in the cinema. Never go to a cinema which has a central aisle. Always make sure you've either got two aisles or that really G12 really is present. So you see the limitations of this complicated art we have created. So I think those considerations should be very much brought to bear. I have a theory, in fact, that cinemas have held cinema back. You know, cinemas are black boxes, basic, the same all over the world, and they're constructed in such a way, rather exactly as you are here, and they're still being constructed, even though we're seeing the end of cinema, that somehow or other, that maybe in the 1930s, we should have thought of cinema in a different way, and recreated cinema architecture in a different way, which have helped cinema, in fact, to have gone forward. Okay, mentioning the word Disney again, of course, Disney realizes this, and now we have multiple screens, and we have projections on the floor and the ceiling. We have a sensorround experience of audio. And if you go to sort of Disneyland, even your seat can begin to move. And there are certain experiments which were somewhat unsuccessful, like the smellies, so that you can associate indeed the experiences of temperature and smell in association with the phenomenon. These things are all comparatively recent, aren't they? Well, at least since the 1950s, maybe the 1960s, but you think that maybe they should have been invented a long, 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 long time ago. Well, considering all these possibilities and all what's possible, I was always curious that probably a play in a theater affects the theater, but does a film projected in a cinema affect the cinema? What is the screen doing for you as a screen, which again is always basically a parallelogram, four right angles? The 1950s, a filmmaker could change his aspect ratio. You remember those games, or perhaps you don't, but maybe by hearsay, of notions of VistaVision and Todeo, and even the first production of Kubrick's 2001, which was played on an extremely wide post cinema screen, which is what, 1 to 2.35, but also was curved, and not simply curved that way, but curved that way as well. rather limited experience, it's almost impossible, of course, to remotely see Kubrick's 2001 on anything like the way he prepared it, because the technologies have all changed. But it is interesting there were attempts, in a sense, to mould cinema architecture to fit what we actually thought was a notion of a cinematic experience. Well, thinking about this, and also having this exhibition in a design museum in Milan, and I suppose, you know, the self-reflexivity about notions of design was relative, I wanted to see why we are limited, in fact, to parallelogram screen under this particular sort of relationship. We were given, again, remember, as a design museum, all sorts of possibilities. One of the first things, again, thinking of Abel Gance, and I think I've been doing it now for 20 years, is to try and make cinema on simultaneous multiple screens. Well, we could do that. But why stay with the parallelogram? Let's change the shape, and let's make the new shapes of the screen be a metaphor for what you project on them. So there is a direct relationship between the flatness of the screen, or in some cases, not the flatness of the screen. It is quite possible to project on all sorts of complicated shapes now, and to make a architectonic cinema, a cinema that's environmental, so that you can enter into it, you can go around the back, you're certainly not fixed to your seat. A lot of our screens also, I'll show you in a minute, had that other possibility, which is probably only relative to technology of the last 10 years, of being either completely opaque or semi-opaque, or essentially, in a sense, virtually 90% see-through. So they had different varieties of visibility, if you like. And when you juxtapose those screens, often you could see screens through screens. And you can imagine that this would certainly be symptomatic of an architectonic cinema of the future. Let me just show you the parameters of this, and then I will show you the particular essay that we performed on it. So remember, this is a couple of years ago now, and it was at the Design Museum in Milan. And what I wanted to do, first of all, was indeed to change the nature, size, scale, and aspect ratio of the screen. So here's our first screen. Can we slightly lower the light so we can see this? That red figure, of course, is meant to be symptomatic of an Italian male, age 23, in a full height. And he's relative again, and you can see the proportions of the screen, which I'm afraid is slightly off the frame. I don't know whether the projectionist can rearrange the frame size. Can you zoom out just a little bit? It actually represents, and of course this is a diagrammatic representation in two dimensions, but I'm thinking of a quarter of the Earth. So it's if the Earth is represented by a circle. And so therefore, in a sense, it represents the overview, the ability of containing the really, really, really wide shot. The Italians supposedly, or should we say the Latins, the Romans, invented the triumphal arch. There are many, many of them, more than, less than a kilometer from this theater. And there is a way, I suppose, the metaphor for the triumphal arch is to do with notions, I suppose, of splendor, spectacular, and certainly triumphalism. So there's a way that we can organize maybe everything that we feel fits those metaphors into that particular frame. Again, the frame, the frame, the frame. Is it not true that maybe the best way to represent the snake traveling around on the grass, snake being a very horizontal animal, is to have the widest possible screen? Again, I'm sorry, can the projectionist zoom out a bit more so we can see the extent? Is the projectionist still awake? Hello, Mr. Projectionist. Could we zoom out, please, to see the whole diagram on the screen?
Zoom out.
Other way. Okay, this if we finally do see the end, is far, far wider than the widest screen you've ever seen. There are one or two screens now in Rotterdam Station, I live in Holland, which are, I think, about three times as wide as this. Spectacular. I'd really like to make cinema on an extremely wide screen, can you imagine? But it's relative, of course, to the horizon most manifest when you look out to sea. But if I'm going to concentrate again on that notion, and I've talked about snakes in the grass, what about giraffes? Don't we need a tall, tall, tall frame to be able to adequately isolate and frame a giraffe? It's interesting, isn't it? I think the whole life on Earth is contained in about 8 kilometers? Mount Everest plus another kilometer, and then what, maybe 2-3 kilometers underneath the frame of the Earth. And there's a way, of course, I've diagrammatically created a trapezium here, 2 dimensions into 3 dimensions, to give you an indication that not necessarily are these screens exactly parallel to your picture plane, so some of them can be talked. And since I have an awful lot to say, I've given myself 3 note screens, if you like, 3 extra screens to pick up the information. Okay, in general terms, and I don't want to be so slavishly particular that all the wide shots have to appear on the wide screen and all the small shots, the close-ups, and the details and the still lifes have to appear on the small screen. These are the parameters. Now remember, the size is indicated, of course, by that gentleman there, that little red dwarf there. And you can go around the back, and you can take up. You're not limited to G12. You can maneuver. You can find your own space, just like you do when you came to this building. You are not rigidly created and rationed only with 1 square meter, 2 square meters to stand in. You are free to move. All right, well, the subject matter then, which is relative to, I suppose, Italian design. The original parameters of the exhibition were Italian design from, I think, 1945, the end of the Second World War, up till, I think, about the year 2010. I wasn't allowed to initially do much before that because it became another sort of subject matter altogether. And surprisingly, I was not supposed to include designers who, though they might be very old, were certainly still alive, because it created too much notions of Italian jealousy. But maybe that's another phenomenon. Anyway, have a look at what we did. I have to make a comment. One of the reasons why you were invited into this auditorium late, because we were struggling to get the right color balance. I take a certain pride in making extremely well-wrought images on very, very 4K high definition. And of course, that will only be valid in camera terms if it's also valid in projector terms. And so we're all demanding extremely high resolution in theaters like this, but unfortunately it's not always possible. So some of the color balances, I'm sure you'll recognize at once, are unsatisfactory. Let's have a look.
Thank you.
as you could see, the brief was broken because we are indeed going back. I think images there from Pompeii. So let's say it comes from 70 AD, certainly up till the end of the Second World War. Trekking the way through all those periods, indeed, not only of Italian art history, but of European or Western art history in general, and you can recognize the periods, finding a metaphor and a way of explaining the particular characteristics, and also making a full embrace of everything you can think of, sculpture, painting, easel painting, graphic arts, notions of calligraphy, etc., all the way to photography. But again, if I can retrace, remember my four tyrannies, the tyranny of the frame. We've certainly broken the frame, created possibilities, got away from the seat G12 phenomenon. Notions of text is remarkably, if any, text, and the text there is text essentially as image, not as text. Actors, well, this is a sort of a consideration of human design, so the seats that you are now seated on have to be relevant to your buttocks, so there is a way that remind you constantly of the naked human form. A lot of you are wearing glasses in the room. Those glasses have to be related to the shape of your face, so again, the physicality of the human form is omnipresent. And what's the fourth tyranny? The fourth tyranny is the camera. Well, again, all sorts of exploration. Some indeed is mimetic camera works, shooting what's put in front of it or recreated. But there is a great sense of a self-consciousness of the notion of what the camera does. Okay, so what is this saying about notions of contemporary media? Well, I think we have to change the shape of our cinema architecture. Now, you're not going to be able to find a venue to be able to project that, at least the minimum of 7 screens here, certainly within 5 miles of this auditorium. But there is a way in which, as I'm sure you've all been to Times Square in New York, has 126 screens. Can you imagine what cinema could be with that diversity? Those screens are all not organized, always flat to you as you sit or stand in the middle of a traffic jam in Times Square. They're all at different angles, different proportions, different heights to create an environmental notion of a singularity of cinema. I certainly believe that, and there's some indication it's already beginning to happen. Anybody been to a concert of Lady Gaga or Beyoncé? These people well understand what's happening here and the potentiality of it, but why should it just remain in the hands of those particular people? It's for all of us both to make and to enjoy. As a notion, again, of the multiple framing, and also connected to a very, very sensitive subject matter, I've been involved in the Uranium Festival in Rio, which is pushing hard to make us all very aware of notions of atomic power. And not so long ago, we put together a film about the atomic bomb. I was absolutely surprised to realize that from Hiroshima to about the first breakdown of atomic energy internationally, what's that, about 1989, maybe a little later, there were over 2,000 atomic bombs dropped on the planet Earth. And we made an accumulation. It was, in a sense, I suppose, a project of research, but to find out where these bombs had been dropped, what was their capacity, who was responsible. So we came up with, again, an excessive multi-screen phenomenon. Take a look at this.
encompassed a greater variety of military effect studies than any previous nuclear test did.
Thank you.
okay, if you like, cinema of accumulation, which is both an exposition but also an critique, if you wish, of the notions of the information age, which certainly, concerning itself with a very serious subject matter, is also aestheticizing, if you like, the notions indeed of all these atomic bomb explosions, and continue to make sort of patterns of various descriptions and color and taste, etc. The notion, I suppose, of this multiple imaging related certainly for me to a series of experiments we did with the whole notion of VJing. You know the phenomenon of VJing. VJ artist does what a DJ artist does, the latter with music, and indeed the filmmaker or practitioner with notions of picture. I mentioned again about cinema going back to its origins. What about the idea now, since the manipulation of computers and screening is becoming so easy and so possible, to be able to consider the notion of cinema being present tense? You know, most cinema is past tense. Casablanca, unfortunately, every time you look at it, is always the same. Why should it be the same? I can now make a film on a Monday, change it for a Tuesday, change it for a Wednesday, change it for every day of the week. Can be absolute murderous for cinema managers, of course, but then why should we worry about them? The actual aesthetics of the cinema should dictate the way that you see it. So I'm interested in the idea of the notion of cinema in terms of present tense and the excitements of being able to manipulate that to a certain extent in terms of the VJ show. And we, I suppose, did about 40 or 50 of these all around the world. We did them on beaches, we did them in opera houses, and we did them in, here's an image of the Pirelli factory in Milan. We did them in town squares. We shut off the lights in São Paulo with the help of the police and did them at a big traffic intersection. The idea basically to engage very, very big screens, and of course with a huge amount of noise, and to collaborate with DJs of various descriptions. But what this also set up was a different way, I suppose, which I suppose James Joyce was all anticipating it in literature, what, 70, 80 years ago, was the notion of the loop. Okay, the loop's been with us ever since Dali and Buñuel, with the idea of the mesmeric loop, creating a piece of film. Often that film developed in all sorts of complicated ways related to contemporary editing, which becomes like the word in a sentence, or the sentence in a paragraph, or a paragraph in a chapter, or a chapter in a novel. And by running all these singular looped images together, in a way offers an audience possibilities of making their own film from the disparate parts. Having said that, I became actually fascinated in the loop itself. Let me demonstrate some of these activities and see if I can entertain you. So here's a series of loops. I'm offering to you them individually, one at a time, but imagine there is a way in a live environment I can offer you many of these so that you can recreate, in a sense, your own idea of cinema.
In 1940, the Vicomte was plundered, and along with the German High Command for Northern France, its paintings, furniture, drawings, mirror, staircases, plants, trees, statues, and fountains were moved to Versailles. In 1940, the Vicomte was plundered, and along with the German High Command for...
Dressing up and hiding in history was over. Charlotte Desarbes, teller of tales of love, momentarily retired. Dressing up and hiding in history was over. Charlotte Desarbes, teller of tales of love, momentarily retired.
Fire! 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 When not being able to swim, he drowned. When not being able to swim, he drowned. When not being able to swim, he drowned.
Thousands of thousands of missing persons searched for in the closing months of the war and for the 5 years after. Looper was not so very significant. Among the thousands of missing persons searched for in the closing months of the war and for the 5 years after. Looper was not so very significant.
Story 1001. Suitcase 89 contained a typewriter that, on examination, proved to be the typewriter on which all the Pulse Looper manuscripts were typed. Eyes, noses, mouths, hands, genitals, feet, toes. Eyes, noses, mouths, hands, genitals, feet, toes. Eyes, noses, mouths, hands, genitals, feet, toes.
But I don't think you're gonna get anywhere special much before it gets really black, dark night. But I don't think you're gonna get anywhere special much before it gets really black, dark night. But I don't think you're gonna get anywhere special much before it gets really black, dark night.
Shivery cold. Shivery cold. Shivery cold. Shivery cold. Shivery cold.
Now kiss my ass, Englishman. Now kiss my ass, Englishman. Now kiss my ass, Englishman. Now kiss my ass, Englishman.
It was undoubtedly a cover. He was really collecting material on the rapidly gathering brutality in Europe. It is not absolutely certain who came to arrest Looper in Antwerp, but of the company, three and possibly four of them had auditioned to become his permanent jailers. They were to haunt his life. It was undoubtedly a cover. He was...
And the jailer is as much a prisoner as the prisoner.
The ideal prisoner and the ideal jailer are interchangeable. Am I the ideal prisoner?
You're a spy and an enemy of Belgium. And the jailer is as much a prisoner as the prisoner.
The ideal prisoner and the ideal jailer are interchangeable.
Send him a present to show him our appreciation, our affection. Show him that he'll be well looked after with us.
Just send him me.
We should...
When a body,
the man who met himself,
is holy.
What sort of chin have you got, Lupi? Average.
Why do you look like that?
Okay, a given to them, let me repeat. Artificially. But you can see we're using the huge variety of editorial tricks, animations, virtual animations, old-fashioned animations, pieces of other art forms like, indeed, opera. A lot of it initially manufactured in another context with me, in order to create a huge vocabulary of possibilities, of visual excitements and possibilities, which are then put together, again, multiple projection, in a public arena. Often, I think we had 10,000 people in a production we did in Krakow, in a busy intersection of obviously a popular city, late on a Saturday night. So it wasn't in a refined environment like this. It was essentially out there in the notion again of, shall we say, the real world. I have to define what real is, of course, rather than the superannuated world that would exist in a filmic environment. And again, I suppose, let me repeat, it's a bit like going back to, indeed, when the cinema, certainly in Europe of, the 1900s, 1910s, would often be a mixture of live entertainment, where you get the theatrical physicality in association with cinema. I'm making a series of operas. We're about to make an opera about Hieronymus Bosch with Philip Glass for the year 2016, where, again, that notion of using all the excitements of contemporary post-cinema technology in association with live action. So there might be a way, indeed, that the cinema of the future might be able to recreate those particular sorts of excitements. The possibilities, of course, are endless and endless. I think we now have 6,000. We have 6,000 of these loops, in a sense, every time we do a VJ performance. Such is the huge vocabulary we can play with that no two performances are ever remotely alike, which, again, I think is related to that phenomenon of, cinema ad nauseam, cinema ad infinitum, not limited anymore by the straitjackets of managerial time, like the 120-minute notion of the feature film. Another particular area in association with very contemporary technology is the excitements I would like to continually discuss between the associations between 8,000 years of painting and only, 119 years of cinema. So we've embarked upon a program we call Nine Classic Paintings Revisited. Having been a painter, both practicing, I still am, I have an exhibition coming up very shortly in Prague, but also practicing in cinema, one can continually see the advantages and the disadvantages, the downsides and the upsides of both media. Rather cheaply, several years ago, I said to an Italian journalist who asked me, why, Mr. Greenaway, have you moved from painting to cinema? I said I was always frustrated about painting because they never had soundtracks. And I suppose in a curious way, cinema is painting, one would like to imagine, with soundtracks. A lot of other things besides, of course, but there's a sort of basic, I suppose, bottom line why, for me, this association, the dialogue between painting and cinema is so significant. We started off in the year 2006 in Amsterdam with, indeed, this famous painting, Rembrandt's The Night Watch, and we constructed it in such a way that we could not exactly turn it into a film, not to make an animation, but to interact with all these figures by photographing the original painting, virtually centimeter by centimeter, and isolating all the individual parts. Like this gentleman in the foreground here, his name is Banning Cock, we could actually isolate the highlights in his eye. And being able to do that, it gave us power to be able to manipulate the whole painting. So we could change the color, we could change the contrast, and we could thereby simulate notions, indeed, of all sorts of dramas. It was very, very successful, and a lot of museums all over the world and art galleries suggested, because people could see it's a fantastic educational tool. You can begin to understand notions of composition, 2D versus 3D, ideas of chiaroscuro. Here's Rembrandt, who's the master, one of the real masters of chiaroscuro, notions of contrast and light, which, of course, is very, very important for cinema. So much so that I think those four enormously important painters working round about the year, 1610. First one, of course, is your Caravaggio, master of light techniques, artificial techniques. The second would be Velázquez, who actually attempts to create, I suppose, even the notion by all sorts of subtle tricks of movement in painting. And we're thinking, what movement in painting in 1610? And then indeed Rubens, who begins to make a consolidation about sort of huge multimedia phenomenology that he was associated with. And I suppose the last of the four would be Rembrandt. So Caravaggio, Velázquez, Rubens and Rembrandt, the first painters of artificial light. And what is cinema? No more than the manipulation of artificial light. So I don't think that necessarily the Lumiere brothers invented cinema. I think that these four great painters of artificial light working in round about the year 1600 were probably the world's first four film directors. The exhibition in Amsterdam was successful, and we were very pleased to be invited to tackle this extraordinary painting, a painting that everybody knows from tea towels and birthday cards. Nobody ever looks at it anymore. But it is an extraordinary painting with a great sense of notions of perspective and a sort of sense of gravity and gravitas about it, which should never idly be forgotten, one of the supreme paintings of all time. So we went to Milan and we got Berlusconi's signature because the art establishment was basically against us doing it. I don't think Mr. Berlusconi knew what he was signing, but that didn't matter. It gave us the permission to go ahead. So we made extraordinary projections onto the original painting, which, as you Italians know, is all falling off the wall. Vasari said it was falling off the wall 15 years after Leonardo put down his brush. But that, again, I think, would also give us license that Mr. Leonardo da Vinci would be fascinated by what we did. Indeed, let me show you what we did. In order, because he was very fascinated by all forms of new technology. One of the reasons the painting is falling off the floor, it's not exactly a fresco, it's a water-based painting onto dry plaster, but not content with the ability of the painting to really live, he began to add things like paraffin and gum arabic, and of course the science didn't work very well, and all sorts of chemical reactions began to settle in, and as Vasari said, it was falling off the wall 15 years after he'd finished it. Let me just show you the sort of things that we did with that painting, but the series goes on. We did, we attacked this painting indeed in Venice, Veronese's The Marriage, recording the first miracle of Christ. We are about next year to tackle this extraordinary painting by Velázquez, Las Meninas, which is in the Prado in Madrid. This Picasso, which is in the Reign of Sophia, is supposed to be tackled next year, but all sorts of political problems, of which I'm sure you know, it really belongs to the Basque nation, and it's hanging in the wrong place, so very difficult to get over the political problems. Here's one of Monet's versions of the Water Lilies. This one is actually in the Tuileries Gardens in Paris. There's this famous Cerciura, the La Grande Jatte, which is in Chicago, this Jackson Pollock, which is the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and I can hardly believe this is possible, but apparently we have one or two cardinals on our side that in the year 2020, if I'm still alive then, we will see if we can tackle this extraordinary painting. Now, you probably don't know what on earth I'm talking about and how this is operating. I have not the possibility of showing you maybe the Veronese, which is the greatest attempt, I think, of what we're doing at the moment, but I can backtrack a little and show you what we did with Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper. Here we go.
Thank you.
Okay, there's one more thing I want to show you, which is very, very recent. This thing is so recent that at the end of the month, really, it has its official presentation in Lucca, up in the north of your country. And it's a collaboration with the choreographer Roberto Castello in a series of examinations of how to tell a story. I've obviously mentioned in my talk to you here today about the anxieties about narrativity, about how do we utilize the notions or the relevance, if you like, about non-narrativity. Do we go right back to the beginning? I always think maybe the best way to tell stories is to tell them to children, where there's no problems about suspension of disbelief, and to tell them in the straightest possible way, which is virtually as an oral experience. But that's not sufficient if you're going to introduce notions of cinema. So here's an experiment in sense in storytelling, in narrativity, and it was projected on the open air of a Franciscan church in Lucca. Witness the particular shape and the aspect ratios of the imagery that I am desperately looking for to show you. Give me one moment. There's a lot of stuff here. There's about 30 hours worth of material from the last 4 or 5 years. It would be very nice to show you a lot more, but I'm afraid that time is pressing. Here we go. The Towers of Luca Hubri. Said that the Ink Tower would rise up like a snake to devour the starlings over the Piazza San Martino.
Come un serpente per divorare gli storni sopra Piazza San Martino. Vandi bought a plot of land in the Via della Stufa that was too narrow to build a house. So he built a tower instead. The kitchen was in the basement, and the dining room was on the roof, so he had to get used to eating his pasta cold.
Costruirvi una casa. Allora ci costruì una torre. La cucina era nel piano interrato, la sala da pranzo sul tetto. Così dovete abituarsi a mangiare la sua pasta fredda.
Thank you.
Okay, there's another 20 minutes worth of that. There are 14 stories in all, but an attempt to examine, I suppose, going back to the beginnings of narrativity and trying to reinvent it in terms of contemporary cinema. Lots more to say, a lot more to show you, but I'm afraid our time has run out. Thank you.